Good morning, folks. If you missed last night's video, when volcanoes almost killed a continent, it's got an interesting look back to the 6th century dust veil, and it's linked for you below. Let's get started over at spaceweathernews.com. We're finding the last 24 hours on our star with coronal holes north and south, and the bright active region incoming from the eastern limb. It is notable that the northern coronal hole here looks to be at low enough latitude to affect Earth with solar wind. We'd be expecting that early in the week. Meanwhile, the solar wind is currently calming back down after the impact and geomagnetic storms of 2 days ago. Pressure is easing at a steady rate. So let's focus on the incoming sunspots. Note the looping umbral magnetic fields. And now let's take a moment to come down and see the spots. A nice line latitudinally spread with the large lead umbra, but the magnetic look reveals only a beta classification with a perfect split down the middle, positive blue trailing, red negative lead. This is why when we come back to the ionized iron view in 171 angstroms, we pretty much only see circuit connections positive to negative side to side, whether at large or small scale. What we'd need for solar flares is a mixing of the magnetism down at the umbral level that could interlace or twist these loops. Quick note, if you recall, it was the Midwest taking the strongest geoelectric potential from Friday's solar storm. Pretty much the lowest latitude auroras seen were right there around Purdue University, which is not that far north, and with a nice profile of the high altitude excitations versus the lower atmosphere ones. Probably not a coincidence in the data map there. Largest quake of the last day was a 5.8 south of Australia. Antarctic faults have been active this week, but as a globe, we have indeed been below average quaking this last week as well. We're going now to an amazing 4K tour of the moon. We've got stop-offs at critical features and slides to more interesting data overlays. The full video is linked for you below and is over 4 minutes long, contains many other things we didn't get to show you here. The most interesting portion for me would be the rectangular plateau with craters and an enormous valley running away and down through the surface. The mineralogy suggests it is interesting as well. Let's go to the Rutgers Snow Lab. We want to get everyone familiar or re-familiarized because when April hits the charts, it's going to look fun. As is, in North America, we have seen more snow this spring than since the 70s. And also, we continue to see the focus on spring ever more inappropriate. You likely know that on climate.gov, one of the main data panels is spring snow cover, and it is in decline, one of the key data points shown. The issue is that during wintertime, and especially in the fall, snow totals are rising. Again, this is really just a refamiliarization before April closes and is added to the data. By the way, this last system that rolled through not only broke snow records in the upper Midwest, but has parts of Minnesota solidly annihilating the record cold first 20 days of the month. Last little story here is that grasslands are going to react the same way phytoplankton do to more carbon dioxide in the air, the same way every living creature on this planet acts when there's more food around. It eats. Folks, in honor of the milestone we all hit together this week, CAT declares today to be 25% off day at otf.sells.com. Whether it's a book or some observer's gear, use the code SUN100 to get the discount. Don't forget about last night's volcano video. We've got your wind maps and shots of our star to close. We greatly appreciate your support, and we'll do this all again tomorrow, right here. But right now, it's 4:45 a.m. in the new Valley of the Sun. Eyes open, no fear. Be safe, everyone.